Nishme Pocho Vega Big Vorot Yesha Yemino. Ele Barechev, Ele Basusin, Vanahu Besham Adonai Eloenu Naskir. Hema Karu Venaflu, Vanahu Kamnu Venit Odad. Adonai Hoshia Meler Ganenu Beyon Panenu.
Thank you. And then we're going to read number 100. Kuf. Anybody wants to read?
I could read.
Kuf.
Kuf. You want to read?
100, yes.
It's not it.
I like numbers.
Any. 100. Okay. You want it here?
Mizmor letoda hari ula Adonai kol haaretz. Tigdu et Adonai besimcha bo lefanav biyonana. דיו כי אדוני אלוהים הוא עשנו ולא אנחנו עמו בצון מראיתו. בואו שערב בתודה חצרותיו בתהילה הודו לו ברכו שמו. כי טוב אדוני לעולם חזו ועד דור ודו אמונתו.
Then 121. שיר למעלות.
שיר
למעלות. אלף, anybody wants?
Me too. Okay, continue.
Vas-y, Revital, tu veux?
Yeah, I can read it. שיר למעלות, אשא עיניי להרים, מאין יבוא עזרי. עזרי מאם אדוני עושה שמיים בארץ, אל ייתן למוט רגלך, אל ינום שומרך, הנה לא ינום ולא ישן שומר ישראל. אדוני שומרך, אדוני צילך על יד ימינך. יומם השמש לא יקח וירח בלילה. אדוני שמרך מכל רע ישמור את נפשך. אדוני שמור צאתך וברכה מעתה ועד עולם.
אמן.
And 130. Uflamed.
I read these every day. That's why.
Oh, Sandrine, you're cheating. That's not fair.
Where?
Okay, you have a privileged daughter. You're allowed to.
No, me vamos.
Thank you so much. Okay. May I Kadosh Baruch Hu listen to all our prayers and may we be zoche to hear good news and to receive Mashiach Tidkenu Vimera Vimenu Achshav already. Okay. So the parashat of the week, and I'm so sorry, but it's Vayigash because it's her birthday. And usually it goes on Vayechi, but this week is Vayigash, okay? We're cheating. Okay, so let's go back a little bit on the story that leads us to this parasha, so we know exactly what to expect and how we're going to
maneuver
to speak or not to speak. That is a question. I felt like very like Shakespearean today.
Exactly. I was thinking about it.
Exactly. To be or not to be. Okay, so what happened in the previous episodes? So in the previous parashot, we saw that Yaakov had 11 sons, okay? And 12 sons, really, at that time already. Yeah. Well, I was going to go too far away from that. It's not interesting to go through that. So he has 12 sons already. The last one is Binyamin. Binyamin was born the day Rachel, his mom, passed away. She passed away giving birth to Binyamin, okay? And she was left buried in Bethlehem, okay, where she is still laying today and where we go and visit her at the Kever Rachel, okay? So after that, we see an episode that is very, very sad, okay? Apparently very sad and very tragic. And every year when we read that parasha, I know that we're like, no, It's not going to happen this year. Not going to happen. The brothers of Yosef are jealous of Yosef's of Yaakov's love for his son Yosef, who is the firstborn of Rachel and Yaakov, and they decide to get rid of him. Okay, basically, I make it short. There is a plot against him, and he's left for dead in a well, where scorpions and snakes are ready to attack him. Okay, we can imagine that he's even without any clothing, since his clothing will be brought full of blood, the blood of a goat, though not his own blood, to his father, Yaakov, as a proof that he has disappeared. We don't know what happened to him. Okay, but the truth is, they left him there for dead, and he was actually saved, and he was sold to the Egyptian, really not really directed to the Egyptian, but he ends up being sold to a very important Egyptian, Potiphar, and as a slave. Okay, now,
Christian, yeah, question. Who sold him? The brothers, or they found him in the pit? The Ishmaelim and Tikrit.
I think they left him and then they came back. They came out and sold him. His brother Yehuda came back because he felt guilty.
Yeah, and that's why it's very important that today we're going to see another conversation and another moment between Yehuda and Yosef.
Yes.
And at the end of the life, at the end of history, when we are waiting for Mashiach, there is again another encounter between Mashiach ben Yehuda and who is ben David and ben Yehuda, and Mashiach ben Yosef. So it is very interesting to see that we are witnessing the birth of Mashiach somehow. There is something very royal, and there is a real definition of Malchut within all those episodes, the Malchut of Israel. So it's very, very interesting to see that. Yeah, royalty. Okay, so are you following there? Yeah?
Okay.
Okay, so what happens? He comes in the house of Potiphar as a slave, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave him a lot of talents and the bracha, which means that everything that he does turns into gold, as we say in French, meaning like everything that he does is a success. He has bracha in all that he does, okay? And therefore, Potiphar, who is a very smart governor of Egypt, of Pharaoh, sees that this guy should not be, it's a shame like to leave this guy as a slave. He deserves to be like at a higher position, like we're missing out having him as a slave, okay? So slowly, slowly, he becomes the assistant of Potiphar. Now, something happens. Yosef HaTzadik, was very handsome. Very, very handsome. He had the beauty of Rachel, his mother, right? And Rachel Imenu was beautiful. Because he was very handsome, and you know when we say Ben Porat Yosef, like when somebody is very nice, you can say Bi'ainara or Ben Porat Yosef. All the grandmas used to say, oh, yeah. Ben Porat Yosef, your son, he's so beautiful. Yeah. Okay? So it comes from Yosef HaTzadik. He was beautiful. And this very powerful woman, Mrs. Potiphar, Mrs. of Potiphar, like a very noble lady, okay? She said, there's no way this guy is resisting me. Nobody resists me in this kingdom. Mm-hmm. So she's going to do everything in her power, and she is very powerful and very beautiful, to have him. At one point, seeing that there is no way that this Hebrew, because he was known as Yosef the Hebrew, okay, Ha-Ivri, and we're going to see why he was called the Ivri. He arrives, and it's a festive day. It's in Egypt, and everybody goes to the Nile to celebrate the idol Nile, the river. And at that moment, she decides, she pretends she's not feeling good. He's a Hebrew, so he's not going to celebrate that festivity. And they are the two of them in the house. She pretends she's not feeling good. And she calls Yosef. He arrives and she tells him, I want you, da, 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 whatever. Like I'm writing over the script. Okay. And she sees that he's not going to submit, to give in. And so she decides to grab him and force him to have a relation with her. But what happens? At that moment, he's an Ivri. All other men would have said, she really forced me into it. It's not my choice. But he's an Ivri. He goes against all odds. Okay? That's when we saw Avraham HaIvri was the first. The second is Yosef. Okay? Avraham was against all odds. He discovered HaKadosh Baruch Hu when everybody was idol worshippers in that moment. And he is getting out of the hand of the most beautiful and powerful woman of Egypt. And how does he do that? He sees at that moment he's an image of his father, yes, in front of him, and he runs and he leaves behind his shirt. Mm-hmm. And it is ripped, right? He's condemned. She pretends that she has been abused by him, and he ran away after. And so what happens is that he is judged and he's condemned to go to prison. Okay, we have the son of Yaakov, who's a tzaddik. He ends up as a slave, goes up the stage of the social of social life to go down again in a prison. Kadosh Baruch Hu. He's a boy. He was 17 years old when he was sold. He's a boy. My boy who came back earlier, he's 17 years old also. Okay?
A young boy.
They're boys. Okay, what does he know about life? And he ends up in a prison. Okay, imagine the prison in Egypt. Yarasma, a long time ago, comes back in Arabic. I don't know who's going to understand. Let's back up. And what happened? There, he probably had a mission to do. That's why HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought him there. We're going to accelerate to go to today's event, because otherwise we're never going to do the class. Okay. When he's in prison, he encounters two people. Those two people are related to Paro. He manages to interpret their dreams, yep, successfully. And when those two people who are close to Paro go out, they tell Paro, we saw that Ivri in jail. He is the most incredible dream interpreter. If you ever need that, da, da, da. Okay. Now, Paro has dreams, very weird dreams, okay, about cows and about wheat, okay? Exactly. But those two dreams, he's trying to interpret them. Nobody's able to do so. He remembers the Ivri in the jail. He makes him come. He comes and interprets it and finds a solution. He says, basically, your dreams reveal that you will have a very big, you will have 7 years of very big wealth of Shefa. Exactly. No, of Shefa. And after that, there will be hunger for another time. So basically, you have to use like a strategy in order to save your people. Otherwise, the entire Egypt is going to die. So Paro puts him as the vice king of Egypt. Okay, our little slave, Yosef, goes up and down to go up again, becoming the vice prince of Egypt. Okay, and now he's the one who saved Egypt, from famine, from hunger, from economical distress and crisis. Okay, now we have our Yosef, who also married Osnat. He had two kids, Menashe and Ephraim and Menashe. By the way, those are the two names that we use to bless our kids, okay, our boys, on Shabbat, okay? We're not going to speak about that because it's not the reason why we are here tonight. And when the famine, when the hunger arrives, everywhere in the area, not only in Egypt, but in Canaan also, what happens? Yaakov and his family are suffering from hunger. And Yaakov, as a good patriarch, says to his kids, we need to do something. We heard that in Egypt, they have a lot of resources. So I'm going to send you to Egypt. You're going to go to Egypt. Go, all of you, but don't take Binyamin, my little son, who is the only one who remains from my love, Rachel. And I don't know where to put the accent. And so you have to go and beg there for food. We need food to survive and to go through this hunger. So now, after 22 years, you have Yosef, who is the vice king of Egypt. He speaks perfectly Egyptian. Okay? I've been here for 20 years. I still don't speak perfectly English, but he spoke perfectly Egyptian. Okay? He looked like the vice prince of Egypt. He looked like an Egyptian. You know, like, walk like an Egyptian. You know that song?
Yes, no? We do.
Like an old song?
Yeah.
Okay, he looked like an Egyptian, okay? And he spoke like an Egyptian, and he was at a very, very high position in the kingdom of Pharaoh. So what happened? What happened is that you have those 10 brothers who arrive after a long journey from Canaan to Egypt, tired because they didn't have food. Okay, and they arrive, and now they are going to meet the vice king of Egypt, the vice prince of Egypt. They have no idea who is behind that title, but he knows because he recognizes them. Okay,
immediately.
Imagine, put yourself in his shoes. That was last week. Put yourself in his shoes. You have been through, I want to say hell. Okay. You have been through the worst nisyonot you can imagine because of someone. Someone who you trusted. Someone who you loved. And
someone
after...
Someone
Someone that you called Achai, or not, because it could have been a husband, it could have been a best friend, it could have been whatever. But in that case, it was his brothers. Okay? And at that moment, a few years after you finally managed to build yourself up, you are in front of a situation when those people need you. Wow.
It's not meant to be.
But it means, what kind of power do you feel at that moment? You have the power over people who made your life a nightmare. A nightmare. Imagine. Just imagine if, God forbid, one of the hostages had the opportunity to take a revenge on someone who hurt him, right? Imagine 22 years separated from his father. There was no phone, there was no WhatsApp, no artificial intelligence, nothing. Yaakov thought that his son was probably dead. At least there was a proof that there was blood on his clothing. So why not?
He knew
nobody came after him. Nobody came to see where he was. He didn't know that his father didn't know. So imagine you are on your own, lost, and nobody ever looks for you. How desperate can you be? Okay?
He's not lost, he's sold.
He feels lost.
Oh, well,
why? Because he's all alone. Not who does he have in his life? Okay, he's not going to mingle with the Egyptians. He's working for Pharaoh, and he's at a certain title, and he, thank God, has Osnat and his two sons. But, okay, what about your roots, your family? He's finally there. They come to him, and they don't know who he is, and they ask. They explain their situation. There we go. We are the sons of Yaakov, and we need food, and we need to come back to our family. Our father is waiting for us. We are like a large family, and we really need you to help us. And something is going to happen that he's not going to reveal his identity last week. He's going to reveal his identity today in our parasha Vayigash. In the previous parasha in Niketz, what do we see? We see that he's going to test them. He's going to create a situation that is so weird. We really can ask ourselves, why are you creating this situation? Just tell them, I hate you for what you did. I resent you. You owe me 22 years of my life. Why are you going to create a situation where you don't say who you are and you are accusing them of being stealers? Basically, he invites them to stay with him and eat. And while they are eating, he puts something in the bag of someone, okay, of one of the brothers. And then he sends them back home. And as he sends them back home, he sends someone, some soldiers of his after them, to check on them. And they find a cup that belonged to the vice king of Egypt. They don't know it's Yosef. And they're trying to see what they can do. But that person who had stolen the cup is Binyamin. Binyamin, the little boy.
Didn't he ask for him to come?
Yeah, first he asked for him to come, but I'm trying to go to today. Exactly. So first he sent the 10 brothers to get Binyamin, okay? Because he said he needed to make sure that it was, that he wanted to see that 11th child, because he wanted Binyamin to be there. Why? It's a, hey, oh la la, hello, Esther, comment ça va? Don't be sorry, we're so happy we didn't even really start. And so they come back. They come back how? What is the deal? Yaakov doesn't want to send Binyamin. He says, there's no way. They say, listen, like, there's no way. We are either dying out of from hunger, or you send Binyamin. Says, but I don't have anyone. Last time I sent one of my sons from Rachel, he didn't come back. I don't want to lose a second child like that. So I will not send him. And Yehuda comes and say, listen, Yehuda is the one who had come to free Yosef from the well and let him be sold by the Ishmaelim. Okay, so Yehuda comes again and goes to Yaakov and he says, Abba, yeah, I am going to be responsible for Binyamin. Don't worry, he will come back, I promise you. He's my little brother. We lost one brother. We will not lose this one. But he comes back to Mitzrayim and there is this plot against the family that Yosef organized. And who is suspected to be the stealer?
Binyamin.
Walia. And there we go. We are finally at our vayigash. What happens? They are being brought back to the palace of Yosef, of the vice king of Egypt, in order to be judged. What did you do? You stole my cup. This is not normal. I'm here to help you. I'm sending you food. You're going back to your family. And this little one stole my cup. This little one will remain with me. He will go in prison. That's how we finished last week. And now, Vayigash Yehuda. Yehuda approaches Yosef, the vice king. He doesn't know that it's Yosef. And now he's going to give everything he has in his power to convince the vice king of Egypt to exchange the hostage, the prisoner. And what is he going to do? He's going to do something beautiful. Yehuda, he's going to use his power of speech. I invite you to read because I didn't print this week. But I invite you to read, and maybe I will post it on the chat, the speech of Yehuda, because really, it's really beautiful. It's beautiful. It's emotionally amazing to be able to read that speech. It's really It comes from his heart, really. Of course, he feels guilt for his brother Yosef, who was sold as a slave. He has no idea that Yosef is this guy.
Mm-hmm.
He promised his brother, his
You're
father.
Still there? Your friends. No, on the computer. They're not there.
Ah, yeah, yeah. Yes. Eden and Sandrine, they just turned off their
sorry.
Yeah, now they're back. See, you want to see them?
Yeah.
Okay. I love those two. You're so cute. I wish you would have been there next to me. I could have hugged you. Okay. Non, moi, je viens pas. Okay, anyways. They are... I'm very easily distracted. I'm so sorry. No, no, it's not you. Okay, so he's going to really pour his heart. Why? Because he's thinking, how can I come back to my father, telling him, whoops, I promised you nothing will happen to Binyamin. And you know where Binyamin is? In a jail, in prison, in Mitzrayim. I cannot do that. There's no way this is going to happen. If I have to sacrifice myself for that, I will. Mm-hmm. I have to convince that prince of Egypt that he has to exchange me. And therefore, from that moment, there is a speech from Yehuda. Yehuda is going to approach. He's coming towards Yosef. That's a very beautiful lesson of how we should be able to speak in such a situation. Because the theme of tonight's class is to speak or not to speak, okay? So now, first, I have to tell you a joke. I'm so sorry. Please. I'm interrupting. Okay.
I love jokes.
Intermission.
Okay, we were in a restaurant with my husband one day, and my husband asked for a toothpick.
Toothpick.
Okay, and we are very French, as you can tell from our accent. And so he goes like that. The lady comes. Yes. I would like to speak, please. Mm-hmm. Yes. So he looks at her and says, I would like to speak, please. Yes.
To speak.
And so he says, no, I would like to speak. Ah, okay. I thought you wanted to speak. Okay. So to speak or not to speak, that is the question. Here we see that in a situation where we... I cried that night. It was so funny.
My dad also one time he wanted to say washroom, but instead he said he wanted to say mushroom pizza, and instead he said washroom.
Mushroom pizza. Yeah, when it's not your own language, you can mix up. It's funny. So when you are in a situation that seems so unfair, okay, and we're going to take an example. Imagine you are arrested, no, God forbid, someone is arrested, okay, for driving at 35 miles per hour on Collins Avenue. And the policeman is going to stop and say, you were driving at 70 per hour, you were reckless driving, speeding, and you're like, I was not. I was at 35. It's true that it's 30 normally, but I was just at 35, right? And he's going to say, I'm sorry, you're not in France here. Don't speak with the policeman. I am the authority. You don't speak, okay? When you're in a situation where you feel it's so unfair, it's not the truth. When you're in a situation like that, when you're in a situation where, for instance, like your kid's teacher is going to call you and tell you things that about your son, and you know that it's not possible, that it's not him, that it's not true. And you feel it's so unfair because you know the other version. You know that maybe there was, okay, he spoke, but because it was, there was someone who had bullied him and he was trying to get away from that. When you're in a situation that is, you know it's not the truth. You know it's not fair, right?
What do you do?
We're going to see.
And you respect that person. It happened to me today.
Really? But that's not a surprise because it happened to me also this week. And you know, it's amazing how HaKadosh Baruch Hu sends us every week the answers of our issues, of our problems, personal problems, in the Parashat of the week.
Wow.
Amazing. And you know that it's not fair. I want to take something that concerns us all, okay, as a nation. doesn't it make you feel so sick and frustrated to read or to hear people saying things about Israel that are not true? This is true. What are you talking about? Oh, you beheaded kids, that we beheaded kids. Are you kidding us? Like, what do you mean? Stupid. To speak or not to speak? Are we going to use our might and our power of speech to convince, to fight this when we know sometimes that there is no fighting it? You are in front of a wall. That person is not going to move.
Sometimes.
What are you going to do? Yeah. Sometimes, and sometimes you also...
You can change.
You can change. So Yehuda is in such a situation, and he's teaching us something beautiful. He's teaching us something. How am I going to open the heart? No, I'm fine. Thank you so much. How am I going to open the heart of the person in front of me? I feel like it's a wall. Mm-hmm. He's not going to change his mind. He's not seeing the truth. How am I going to do that? There is something beautiful for the person in front of you to be able to take what you have on your heart. And Yehuda is teaching us that. He says, in such a situation, Yehuda chooses to speak with his heart. And you're going to see, if you read that part, that he's going to go through all the details. You have to understand. I'm going to tell you what happened. I want to exchange with my brother because 22 years ago, I was in the same situation and I was responsible for my brother. And I was not able, and we lost a brother. And my father almost never survived that. His life was paralyzed after that. I cannot let my father like that. There's no way. Please, I beg you, please, my prince. I don't tell you that to release him, but please let me, please be in his place and you let him out. He is the son of his favorite wife, Rachel. Please let him out. Please let me take his place. Let me be the prisoner. Let me be responsible for that. Wow. Okay, that's amazing. And he does that. We have another friend joining.
So when he said, "Od Avinu Chai."
Attends, c'est pas du tout maintenant.
Ah bon.
Alors, rega. Okay. Now that's Yosef who says that.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But it's not now. We're speaking about Yehuda for the moment. Okay. No, attends, fais pas. I'm kidding. Okay. So what does he do? He speaks the truth. He's going to explain the truth. You could think, who cares? He's not going to care about that. And sometimes you don't even want to go into the details. You just want to fight back. What do you mean? You don't know? What? No. Open your heart. Because the moment you make yourself vulnerable in such a situation and you use your power of speech, your koach hadibur, in order to really influence the person in front of you, you're speaking from one heart to another heart. Shlomo HaMelech in Kohelet teaches us, "Kamayim apanim al apanim ken lev adam le'adam." The same way when you see, when you look at water, the water reflects your face. The same way when you speak to someone with your heart is reflected in his heart. So that's already a beautiful lesson. When we are in such a situation and we want to speak, we have to use our strength, our power of speech, and use our power of emet, say what is true, and use the details by opening your heart. That's a beautiful first lesson.
It didn't work for me today.
But wait, there is another option.
That's right.
And I'm going to bring back here a story of that was told, that was a story from the Chafetz Chaim that was brought back by a rabbi that I listened to once. And it was in 1930 when in Vilna, the Chafetz Chaim was at that time 92 years old, right? And he heard that someone in Radin had a governor over there, had passed a decree that was very, very negative to the Jews, right? So what did the Chafetz Chaim do? Instead of not doing anything or just like complaining about that or being sorry about that, he at 92 years old in 1930 went from Vilna to Radin. Okay, he traveled all the way. He arrived over there and he asked to speak. He asked to speak with the governor who had passed that decree. And he tells him in Yiddish, the governor doesn't speak Yiddish. There is a translator, but he says first, all he has on his heart, dear governor, with all due respect, you don't understand the beauty of learning Torah. Those boys that are in the yeshiva right now, if you take them out from the yeshiva, you don't understand what's going to happen to them. You don't understand what's going to happen to Am Israel. I beg you, please let them learn Torah. Let them be in a yeshiva. Let them sit and let them daven and then learn Gemara. I beg you, please. And when the translator is about to start his work of translating, the governor says, it's okay. You don't need to translate. So the translator says, what do you mean? It came from his heart. And as much as I don't exactly know what he said, it entered my heart. And whatever is his point, I will agree. I will not close down the yeshivot. And the boys will still be able to learn Torah. What comes from your heart goes and enters the heart of the person in front. Sometimes it's not what is said that is so important. It is the intention, the kavana that you have and where it comes from. And if it is based on emet, on truth, okay? So we said that the strength of Yehuda is his koach adibur, the power of speech that we sometimes tend to forget. But it is so important to understand that if we were created in the image of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who created this entire world through speech, through words, okay, with his mouth, if we can say that he has a mouth, it's a spiritual mouth, it's not the same as we have, but it's a symbolic for his spiritual mouth, what we have, okay? We too have the power to create with our words. And we can build people, we can build a reality with our words. So we should really realize that when we are about to speak, we should really put our heart, but realize that I have the power to create a certain reality right now. Which one do I want to create? Okay? So that's one thing that Yehuda teaches us. Okay? Now, let's go to Yosef. So that is the pro to speak, okay? Let's speak in a situation. Now let's go back to Yosef. Yosef is going to do something. Yehuda has poured his heart to him. Can he be insensitive? No. Yosef HaTzadik is full. His heart is full. Not only is he in front of his family that he hasn't seen for 22 years, he heard that his father, who had never come after him, really missed him. He said like, wow, my father almost died from the loss of my first brother. I cannot come back without Binyamin. So he feels like, wow, not only my father is alive, but my father missed me and he loved me. And he would have come after me had he thought that I was still alive. right? Because you imagine 22 years with no. And now he hears that beautiful situation that deserves forgiveness, because we know that when do we forgive someone? We forgive someone when we know that that person placed in the same situation will learn the lesson and will not repeat the bad that he did. And that's what he realizes. Yehuda, today, if he was in front of that pit, he would have saved me totally. He will not repeat. And therefore, he forgives him. But he is emotionally, his emotional jar is full to the point that he can almost not contain his emotions. And what does he do? He could have cried. What would you have done first in this situation?
I'll go to the back, cry. And
come back. He went to the back and cry.
We don't want to know what he did. What would you have done? Okay, you would have cried. Some of you, some of us, will have fainted. We would have get angry. Oh yeah, you don't want to go back home without your brother. Well, let me remind you that it was not the case 22 years ago. Okay.
Yeah, but forgive him.
But wait, we're not speaking about Yosef. We're speaking about how us, as simple human beings, in the same situation, how would you? So you're a tzaddeket. You understand? He's not regretting that thing.
Somebody else.
He doesn't want to be caught again.
The fact that he doesn't want to do it.
Maybe. Okay. And so imagine the person who did the most harm to you, okay, is in front of you. I'm going to ask you, for instance, okay, you have someone who really hurt Am Israel. It's easy to imagine today, right? And he is in front of a soldier. That soldier has the power to tell him, what did you do? I don't care that you regret now. You know what you did? You know what you did?
Oh, you can never forgive that.
Okay.
That's a bad example.
That is not.
I'm an Israeli and I cannot.
Exactly. How can you forget? How can you forgive someone who you loved more than anything? Okay. Okay, I'm like, I understand, but it is a good example because it's the same. He took out, he saw, do you realize what he went through? Like, it is exactly the same. I mean, it's exactly the same. It is comparable. Like, he destroyed 22 years of his life. He left him for dead. He lied to his father. They cut Yosef's life. Apparently, from a non Yosef point of view, from a simple human being point of view, okay? I know a lot of people who would have been very mad and expressed it with anger for much less than this, right? Much, much less, right? What is he going to do? First, he's not going to say anything. He's going to close his mouth and not say anything. That's his first response, right? And he's just going to ask everybody else to leave the room. Yeah. And he's not speaking for the moment. Now I want to comment on that. This is an amazing lesson. Being able not to speak. Being able to use the power of shtikut in that moment where you feel that you're so overwhelmed, whether it's of anger, of anxiety, of resentment, of whatever it is, right? When we are angry, we say, I'm not myself. It's true. So if you're not yourself, don't talk, because you're not going to say something that yourself would have said, right? The power of shtikut. To shave, not to speak. Okay. It's so beautiful. And you know where it comes from? It comes from his mother, Rachel Imenu. Who is Rachel Imenu? What did she taught us? What is her merit? If you remember that midrash that I shared with some of you several times, it's a beautiful midrash that tells the story of Am Yisrael, who is in exile. And Am Yisrael wants to come back home. They want to come back home now. But HaKadosh Baruch Hu is not forgiving them for what they did. And our avot are going to interfere towards HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Avraham Avinu. Hashem, it's me, Avraham. Avraham, I'm the first one to have ever believed in you, to have discovered you, to have spread the knowledge of who you are. I am the Baal Aimuna. I am also the person who was able to sacrifice his son, his only son with Sarah Imenu, for you, by my merit. Forgive Am Yisrael. Kadosh Baruch Hu said, not even by your merit, Avraham. Comes Yitzchak, Kadosh Baruch Hu, I was on the altar, I was on the Mizbeach. I asked Avraham, my father, to tie me very tight so that I would not move. I was ready to die for you. By that merit of giving up my own life for you, please forgive Am Yisrael. No, I'm sorry, my son. Comes Yaakov, comes Moshe Rabbeinu, and Hashem doesn't want to let go. I am not forgiving them for any of your merits. And comes Rachel Imenu. She steps up. Hashem, only you know my story. Only you know my pain. Can you imagine the pain that I had when after seven years of secret engagement with my Yaakov, I saw my father organizing the wedding of my sister Leah behind my back with my only love. And of course I could have said something. I could have gone to her and told her, you know, I am his promised. I am his beloved. You don't deserve to marry him. I am the one who is supposed to marry him. I have my dress ready. I've been sewing it for 7 years. It's been 7 years that it has been planned. He's not supposed to marry you. I renounced to my love for him because I knew that halachically, he was not supposed to marry two sisters, right? So when Lavan decided to get him married with Leah, I knew that I had lost him. I was ready to lose the love of my life for you. Because
were,
I didn't...
I mean, they were allowed at that time because it's before.
But wait. Yeah. No, all the mitzvot were supposed to be done even before. But that's not the point. But yeah. No, it's okay, but you're right. But it's before the gift of the Torah. But still, they were supposed to... They have respected all the laws. But this is an exception. And the... not of everybody too. Don't worry. So it was so painful to have to renounce to this. It was so painful to have to lie to Yaakov when I love him so much. It was so painful for me at that moment. And I didn't say anything because I didn't want my sister Leah to be humiliated publicly. because I know that she was a very sensitive person. I didn't want her to be broken. I didn't want her to be humiliated, because humiliating someone is like killing someone, right? So I used the power of silence at that moment. And do you remember, Hashem, the story of the Dudaim? When after being pregnant for so many times and I was still a barren, my sister Leah, her Bechol, Reuven, comes with Dudaim, who are those flowers that have the segula to enable people to have babies. Do you remember that at that moment, when she told me, not only do you steal my husband and now you want to steal my Dudaim, mm-hmm. how difficult it was to not tell her, hey, you don't understand. I never stole your husband. You did steal my husband. And you have been pregnant so many times and I remain barren. But again, I shushed. I didn't say anything. And by that marriage, you gave me Yosef, my dear son Yosef. Do you know how painful it was? And she starts crying and shedding so many tears. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu looks at her and he says, my dear daughter, dry up your tears. By your merit, I will accept to forgive Am Yisrael. And that's why she was not buried in the cave of Machpelah, but in Bethlehem, because it is on the way to Yerushalayim. And when we will go back home, Bezrat Hashem, another time, soon, Bezrat Hashem, very, very, very soon, we will pass by Bethlehem, we will pass by Ima Rachel, and she will cry for us, and we will be forgiven, okay? So this strength, this power of comes from her. No wonder that he has that power, because who has that power? I personally, when I am very emotionally overwhelmed, I'm going to explode either in tears or in anger and say things that I don't want to say, but the coming out is never positive, because you don't say things that you really want to say. You're out of yourself, right? So this first response of Yosef is not saying anything. Do not speak. But it doesn't stop there. So our question is to speak, not to speak. Mm-hmm. To speak sometimes. Now you're thinking about this. That's terrible. The tooth speak. So yes, we have to speak. And when we speak, we have to bring it from our heart to their heart. Be intelligent in the way we speak and use the power of speech like Yehuda. But in some times, we have to stop speaking. Mm-hmm. Do not speak. Why? Because you are not yourself. You are, you know, there are different levels in psychology. There is a level that we call the stretch level, which is a level where you can work with someone when you're a therapist or when you're a neuro life coach or something. There is the level of stress when the person is overwhelmed, and there is a level of numbness, okay? When the person is so numb, so sad, so that you cannot work with her either. She's shut down. So when she's in a stress level or in a numb level, you cannot work with that person. Yeah. It's not the right moment to speak. When you feel yourself that you are in a stress level or in a numb level, better not to speak. Mm-hmm. That's what the Torah teaches us today.
It's a good idea.
But once you calm down, which is the case now, he had the time to calm down yourself, to come back to a stretched level. Everybody is out of the room now. He's back to himself. What is he going to say? He's going to say something amazing. Ani Yosef. I am Yosef, right? So imagine the head, the face of the brothers. Ani Yosef, Ha'od Avi Chai.
Ha'od Avi Nuchai.
No, Ha'od Avi Chai. Yeah. But is my father still alive? Which is a very weird comment, by the way. Ani Yosef, so first is that's okay. Ha'od Avi Chai, is my father still alive? He knows that his father is still alive. Yehuda just, that was the point of the speech of Yehuda. Mm-hmm. He didn't want to ruin his father's life, right? So he obviously he knew that. So it's very interesting. First he didn't speak, then he decides to speak, but in very short sentence, straight to the point.
Yeah.
Ani Yosef, I am Yosef. Oh, you must feel, you could say, you must feel bad now, huh? Ani Yosef, I'm the one who you hurt. I'm the one you spoke about. But he didn't say that. But he still let them know that this story is not totally done. Ha'od Avichai, my father is still alive after what happened. That was a form of tochacha. That was a form of reproach, but not in a negative way. And this is also something we have to learn. When we are in a situation that we are uncomfortable, what is the purpose of blaming, of putting shame, of humiliating, of saying negative things about that person? Sometimes just a little thing is helpful. I have my sister-in-law once, she was sharing with me, she's a specialist of parenting, and she was sharing with me that when her little, she has 7 kids, Bianaha, Ben Porat Yosef, she has 7 kids, and two of them are very close in age, and they are fighting a lot, mm-hmm. right? 2 boys. And so I asked her, like, what do you tell them? Like, and she said, oh, last time I told him, like, do you like that someone pushes you like that? You could tell your son, what are you doing to your brother? Why are you mean like that? Why are you doing that? Right? And the person is going to feel very bad about himself. The purpose is not that. The purpose is that for that person to realize, for that kid to realize that it's not pleasant to be pushed. So what did she ask? Do you like it when somebody treats you like that? And that's it. It's enough. Because the kid understands. I don't really like it when I'm pushed in my back. Maybe I should not do that to someone else, you know? Oh, but you know her very well, by the way. Joy. Okay, so that is how, like, we should do tochacha. We should not reproach someone by blaming that person. You know what you did to me? You know how I felt for 22 years? You know what it feels to be in a prison? You know what it feels to be a slave? You know, ugh. Yeah, you can vomit as much as you want, but it is not going to help the situation. With your mouth, you can build. So let's build. Let's not destroy.
Mm-hmm.
This is the lesson of tonight, when to speak, when not to speak. There's just one more thing that I just at the end that I forgot I wanted to say. We said Yehuda and Yosef are the Malchut, are the kings. We should remember that the way we use our mouth is bringing the Malchut. Okay, Hasidut teaches, by the way, that Malchut comes through the mouth, right? It means that if we want to be queens, we should use a proper language. We should use our mouth to build and not to destroy.
Mm-hmm.
And to use it when it's the moment to use it and not when it's not. So let's learn from the kingdom of Yehuda and the kingdom of Yosef how to be good queens in our kingdom also.
Thank you.